figured we'd wear them out while we got them. And, if that works for you all, we'll keep them busy. All right. I didn't come with any plans this morning. All right. Let's do that song, What a Journey.
His face I'll see. So good to me.
And when I think
of what he's done and where he's brought me from, I've got so much to thank him for. for
so much,
so much to praise him for, you see. He has been so good to me.
And when
I think
of what he's done
and where he's brought me from, I've got so much to thank him for.
I've got
so much to thank him for,
so much,
so much to praise him for, you see. He has been so good to me.
And when
I think of what he's done and where he's brought me from, I've got so much to thank him for.
Alrighty, well, good morning. I am so glad to be here this morning. And I'm encouraged by some of the visitors that we have. Miss Kim invited her family, so hallelujah goes there. It's a good place for family to be together in church on Sunday morning. I tell you what, it's kind of one of these things where as the world gets the way the world is, it's not getting any better, so church is the place that you and I need to be to get our batteries recharged. So hallelujah. Thank y'all for being here this morning. I'm going to be over in the book of Hebrews this morning. Chapter 4 is where we're going to be our focus today. And Hebrews chapter 4, the book of Hebrews is a very special book to me. It's just, it's overwhelming, if I can put it that way. And what I mean by that is, I tell you, the Lord brought me some scripture last week as I studied up for this message here. It's, I hate to admit it, but it's just overwhelming to the fact that there's just so much in there. And it was really hard to kind of get everything narrowed down into something that even I thought was coherent at all that would make any sense. So this morning, y'all bear with me and pray for me as I preach this morning, because I'll be honest with you. This scripture here is one of these things where, to me, it's easy for me to get distracted. It sure is, because there's just so much in there. I don't know if you guys are like that or not when you study your Bible, but the fact is, sometimes it really overwhelms me. So if you can this morning, grab your Bible and turn over to Hebrews chapter number 4. We're going to start in verse 10. If you don't mind, stand with me here just for a little bit. We'll get through these six verses here, and I'll let you sit down. See, when Hebrews chapter number 4, verse number 10, the Bible says, "For he that entered into his rest, he also has ceased from his own works, as God did from his. Let us labor therefore to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief. For the word of God is quick and powerful, and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of the soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and open unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do. Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need." Let us pray. Oh, gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, I come to you this morning empty. Lord, I studied, well studied, and worked on it hard, Lord, but I need your help, Lord. I need to have the words, the right things to say to help your people grow, Lord. Lord, we just ask you this morning to help the messenger bless the word that spoke. Everything that's done is for your honor and glory, Lord. And the idea is to help grow your people, get them closer to you, encourage the saints this morning to save those that are lost. These things, Lord, we plead in your son Jesus' most precious name. Amen. You can have a seat if you can. All right. Hebrews chapter number 4. I'm telling you, there's so much stuff in here. I've already kind of spilled the beans that it's overwhelming to me because there's just so much in here. Notice in verse 10, now that Jesus Christ, we have rest from the works. If you and I were to think about it this morning, we would see that the works the whole world is working on today would be ways of doing things their way. The works of life, there's many different religions out there that's totally works-based religion. You and I, once we're in Christ Jesus, we are at rest from those works. We don't have to work. We don't have to work at all for our salvation. It's truly a faith thing. So salvation is purely faith and not works. Not anything that you and I could do. It's just basically for what God has done for us on the cross there at Calvary. Christ, because we realize we're in Christ, because we realize that our works can't get us there. It's that rest that we've brought into. I like to think of that song as the haven of rest. You know, once we're saved, we find rest in Christ Jesus. We're not looking at ourselves to bring forth any of our own salvation whatsoever. That's one of the things that always amazes me about some of these other works-based religions is how they seem to never get anywhere. They truly won't ever get anywhere because all of the works that they do and built up isn't as righteous as filthy rags is what our Bible tells us it truly is. So it's not by works, it's totally by faith. So we get the understanding that our works are insufficient in all matters of salvation. You should say hallelujah there. And you should say, Brother Walker, why are you telling us that? Well, it's kind of one of these things where I find rest in the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. I realize it is Him that's taking care of this stuff for me, that I don't have to do it. I don't have to worry about it. I just have to trust in Him by faith. That's all I have. Notice in verse 11, we see where the word labor is given. We see the need of labor to enter into this rest. The rest that is based on faith and our works can't save us at all. You and I, we should strive spiritually so we don't fall into unbelief. How do we do that? Well, every Christian finds rest in the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross. It is because of that finished work that we press on to the finish line to an uncorruptible salvation in the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Notice in verse 12, I hear this one a lot. I've heard a lot of preachers preach on just this one verse, and it is so true. It's talking about God's Word here. Amen. We get a really understanding of it. We are to understand that the Word of God is powerful. Amen. Hallelujah. It's quick, it's powerful, it's sharp, it's piercing. Amen. It is the living. It is the rule by which all things are measured. You and I think about the things in life. We think about how we can measure things and how we should compare things. We should compare things to the Word of God. We should compare the way we live to the Word of God. Amen. Why is that? Because it's pure, powerful, and quick. Amen. The thing about the Word of God, the Bible is called like a two-edged sword. Well, if you think about it this way, if you've ever gotten cut by anything in your life, a chainsaw leaves a real nasty cut. But a two-edged sword is going to leave a nice, clear cut. I mean, I know that sounds a little bit kind of off the cuff here this morning, but the fact of it is it's piercing. It gets to the spot. It takes care of the spot. It's piercing of the heart. The Bible compares it to asunder the bones and marrow. But that's the thing. That's the way the Word of God is. It's supposed to get to the point. It's not supposed to be destructive. That's kind of one of the things I like about it. You know, I've been accused of beating people over the brow with the Bible. I don't know that I've ever done that. I don't feel like I have, but the fact of it is, the Bible's not a hammer. It's a sword. It's a rock, but yet it's not destructive, amen. It leads us away from destruction. It truly does. A two-edged sword is what it's called. The living Word is a discerner, amen. It guides us, it helps us. It's quick to judge and to help us discern the intents of the heart and every thought of our mind. Think about it. This book is like cleansing bleach for the heart and mind. It truly is. It does the work, amen. It is God's holy Word that is powerful and searches out the defects of our hearts, amen. And when I think about the heart defects that it searches out the problems. It searches out our indifference to what God would want us to have in our hearts. It searches those out. Every thought, amen, it's like a spotlight. It shines into our soul to look for anything that God wants to reveal to us to be something that you and I should work on. That's kind of one of these things I was thinking about this morning when I got here. And it's one of these things where I hope I never lose that nervousness when I come to the house of God. I hope I don't ever get where I'm not a little bit concerned about what happens at the house of God. And you say, Brother Walker, have you lost your mind? No, it's kind of one of these things where when I come to the house of God, I'm expecting to meet with Him. That little bit of nervousness that I have, I've realized as I've gotten older, it's one of these things where I'm going to meet with an all-powerful, mighty God, and He just might have something to say to me, amen. That's the nervousness, it is, amen. I hope I never lose it. In verse number 13, this verse lets us know that there's no creature anywhere that is concealed from His sight, amen. There's no thought in your mind, there's no anything that crosses your mind or your heart, anything in your heart that He doesn't already know about. God's omniscience, knowing and seeing everything He truly is. He knows every thought, every secret, amen, every secret. When you think about this holy word that you and I have in front of us today, you got to realize that this was God's gift to us, His holy word. It's for us. If God knows every thought you and I have, He knows everything. He knows everything that was written in this book. You and I have been giving a piece of His mind to learn of His character through this book. It's all for us. It's a gift that He's given to us. It's for us. It's not for Him. It's for us. Amen. He's given that to us this morning. He truly has. He already knows our hearts. He's given us His Word, amen. For what? To expose our hearts. So we get some idea what His heart is, what He expects. Verse 14, this verse shows us the priesthood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Notice where it says about this high priest. We have a great high priest. He was of the order of Melchizedek, but much higher. The priest of righteousness. And then Jesus was much higher than him. Not of Aaron, not of Melchizedek could even hold a candle to him. Amen. They couldn't do it. Won't do it. Amen. Because of this, the Bible says, let us hold fast our profession. Amen. Hold fast our profession. Let us hear His word. Believe His word. Follow His commandments. And hold fast our faith. Amen. That's what we ought to be doing. Our high priest lives today. Hallelujah. Amen. Verse number 15 tells us a little something. That one there should bring forth some real comfort in every heart of every believer this morning. Really, it should bring comfort to the believer, and it should bring even more comfort to the unbeliever this morning. Why is that? Know that the one that created the entire universe and everything in the universe knows everything there is to know about us. We've been given this great high priest given by God, His only Son, given for our sins, amen, to provide escape of the wrath of God through Him, amen, that high priest. He loves, He watches, He prays, He holds us fast, and we shall never perish just for that fact, amen. Our high priest is prepared, He's willing, and He's able to receive and help those that are sick, amen. Does that not give you some comfort this morning? I tell you what, it blesses this old boy's heart. It sure does. He's able to keep what He's promised us in this Bible. Amen. When God makes a promise, it's a promise that lasts for eternity. Amen. He knows our every weakness. He knows our pain. He knows our heartache. He knows our trials. He knows our temptations. He was put through on that cross more than you and I could ever even imagine about bearing. I've never had the skin on my back beat off, but He did. He truly did. I've never been through so shamed and embarrassed the stuff that He went through just leading up to the cross where they pulled His beard and they spit on Him. I've never even encountered anything like, but he has. That gives me comfort. So when I know when Satan's attacking me and putting people against me to attack me and things seem to be going wrong in my life, the fact is that God's already been there and done that. Amen. Already been there and done that. Notice in verse number 16 here, let us therefore come. I like that phrase. I love that. Let us therefore come. Let us therefore come boldly into the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Amen. Why is that? Because of our high priest is holy and perfect. He's acceptable to us. We can come boldly into the throne of grace. Amen. This does not mean we approach him carelessly. Keep that in mind. We don't approach him demanding. We don't go to him with feelings of entitlement. We really don't. Although we are entitled through him, we don't go with him with feelings of entitlement. We really don't. We are invited to come to him without fear in perfect liberty. I love it. I love it. Amen. To make known our needs and our request. Not only does he take care of our needs, he wants our request as well. So this morning, because Jesus is our high priest, holy, pure, and perfect, 100% God, 100% man, we can therefore come. Amen goes there. Everyone can come to Jesus because of these truths I'll give you this morning. Number one, notice this one here. He's accessible. Amen. Amen. You know where I work? I don't have access to, you know, the vice president or the CIO and all these people. But, you know, I have this high priest that I have full access to. Anything I need, I can take it directly to him. I have access to the one that created the stars, moon, and the skies, and the stars, Jupiter, Saturn, Mars. I have access to this being that created all of it, that spiritual being that spoke it into existence. Little old me here, I have access to him. Amen. Amen goes there. He really does. Jesus made himself accessible to everyone, not just me. Not just me. In Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, the Bible says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. Amen. When you're troubled, you got access to the one that can make the difference. There's times in our life where we need something huge. There's times in our life where we need big things. You know, we need to get a hold of somebody that can do something about it. Well, we have access to him. Amen. We truly do. Amen goes there. Jesus had offered us up something that only he can give. Amen. When he went to that cross, he did something for you and me that only he could do. Amen. I couldn't do it. You can't do it. There's no priest that's ever walked on the face of the earth in his earth that could do what Jesus done. Amen. He did it. 100% man, 100% God. He took care of it. In John chapter 4, verse number 10, the Bible tells us, and when he was talking, Jesus said, Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, give to me drink, thou would have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. Amen. He's the one that gave the living water. And I don't know how you feel about it this morning, but it just excites my soul. Every thread of my body this morning just wants to run screaming out that door that I have access to him this morning. I have access to him this morning. I truly do. You know, Jesus is the good shepherd. He is the shepherd that's accessible to his sheep. Amen. That's something I've noticed about sheep. You know, sheep are about as dumb as it gets. They truly are. They get in trouble. They ever fall over on their back, they have to have help to get back up. You know, I'm glad to be one of his sheep. Amen. Amen. I'm glad to know that he leads me. He's not driving me. He's not beating me to force me in the way that he wants me to go. He's leading me. He is my good shepherd. He truly is. In John chapter 10, verse number 16, the Bible says, and other sheep I have, which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice, and there shall be one fold and one shepherd. He's the one, the only one. We didn't need him more than one. He's sufficient. took care of it all. Amen. That's the shepherd. That's my shepherd this morning. The one that's accessible this morning. Notice the rich young ruler in Matthew chapter number 10, verse number 17, when he came to Jesus. He came and asked, he says, and went forth and gone forth into the way. And there came one running and kneeled at him and asked him, good master, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life? Well, the rich young ruler was able to access the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Even the poor and the sick have access to Jesus. They really do. In Luke chapter 17, verse number 11, it says, and it came to pass as he went into Jerusalem, there passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee, and he entered into a certain village. There met him 10 that were lepers, which stood afar off. They lifted up their voices and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on me. Amen. He's accessible. Amen. He truly is. Amen goes there. Number two this morning. He has mercy for all. Amen goes there. Oh boy. I'll tell you what. That's something right there. He has mercy for all. For all. You think that mercy will ever run out? Has mercy for all. Amen. Look in verse number 16. It says, boldly. Come boldly unto the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy. When I think of this mercy that the Lord had, He had for me as a snotty-nosed little brat, and He still has it. He's pouring it out for me every day, He truly is. It's the mercy. It's the compassion. It's the forgiveness. It's shown to someone that doesn't deserve it. Amen. I don't deserve what He did for me, but He did it anyway. I deserve the punishment. He took that punishment away. Amen. The mercy is not getting the punishment we deserve through forgiveness that we don't deserve. Amen. That's what it is. Remember the woman that the Pharisees had brought and thrown down at the feet of Jesus. Amen. And in John chapter 8, verse number 10, it says, when Jesus had lifted up himself and saw no one but the woman, he said unto her, woman, where are those thine accusers? Thou hath no man condemned thee? She said, no man, Lord. And Jesus said unto her, neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. Amen. That's some mercy right there. Amen. Jesus has it. He's rich in mercy. He truly is. Right. When it comes to mercy, He set the standard. He truly did. When you and I think we should be merciful to others because what Jesus set the standard, He truly set the standard in Matthew chapter number 10, number 9, verse number 13, the Bible says, but go ye therefore and learn what that meaneth. I will have mercy and not sacrifice, for I am not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. He came for a sinner like me, amen. He came for a snotty-nosed little boy like me. He did, amen. Jesus shows how merciful He is in Luke chapter number 6, verse 36. It says, be ye therefore merciful as your Father. And in my Bible, I don't know about yours, but my Bible's got an uppercase F right there. Your Father also is merciful. Hallelujah. That tells us God is a very merciful God. Amen. He gave us an escape from wrath through His Son, Jesus Christ, that He loved so. That He loved His only begotten Son. But yet He gave Him for us, amen. He gave it for that snotty-nosed little brat, He really did, amen. Jesus, because of the love and compassion He had for all of us, shows us His mercy. He truly does. In Mark chapter number 6, verse 34, the Bible tells us, and Jesus went and came out and saw much people and was moved with compassion toward them because they were as sheep, not having a shepherd. And He began to teach them many things. I'm glad He's accessible this morning. I'm glad He's merciful this morning. I am. Hallelujah goes there. God making available a way for a sinner like me to have His love and mercy. Amen. In John chapter 3, verse number 16, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. Don't forget verse number 17. It gives us more detail. It says, for God sent not His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. Amen. Hallelujah goes there. Amen. He has an abundance of mercy. Amen. You and I think about this. I don't want to cost Him any more than I've cost Him, but He has an abundance of mercy. Amen. He is full of mercy, rich in it. Amen. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 4, the Bible tells us, "But God, who is rich in mercy, for His great love wherewith He loved us." Amen. "Even when we were dead in sin, hath quickened us together with Christ." Amen. By grace are you saved. Amen. By His grace. Boy, I'm glad I'll never bankrupt Him. Amen. I'm glad He'll never run out. Amen. And I watch my bank account a lot of times go taking nosedives. But, hey man, God's grace ain't never going to get low. Hallelujah this morning. It's never going to get low. Amen. I'm glad He had mercy for my wretched soul. Amen. "Come to Him, for He's merciful to all." Hallelujah. Amen. Number three this morning. He is there in the time of need. I don't know how you guys make it through life if you don't have the Lord Jesus Christ. But if you do, you know you can go to Him for all things. Stump toes, He cares about. Amen. Cuts and scrapes and little burns on your fingers, He cares about. Paper cuts, He cares about. The big things, the big cancer word, He cares about. Every one of them. There's nothing that you go through that the Lord doesn't care about. Amen. You're one of His. He loves you. You are a child of His. He's concerned with you. Amen. And guess what? We can take all of our needs to Him. We surely can. Verse 16 gives us that promise. It proves it to us. "And find grace to help in time of need." You and I got needs this morning. We can take it to the one that can do something about it. Amen. We can't take our needs down to the convenience store. The guy running the convenience store couldn't care less of our needs. Maybe there's a real sweet fellow running one. I don't know. But the fact is, that's the wrong place to take our needs to. We take them to the King. Amen. In Psalms chapter 46, verse number 1, the Bible tells us, "For God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble." Amen. What a truth. God is always there in our time of need. Amen. He is our refuge. We can run to Him in our time of need. In Proverbs chapter number 18, verse number 10 tells us, "The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous runneth into Him and is safe." Amen. I can run to Him, and where I can get rest and I can be safe with Him. I surely can. Because we can come to Him, our great high priest. Amen. He is our strength. You and I, we don't have to fight our own battles. We just have to have Him on our side. Amen. Whatever He gives us, it's the power. Amen. The Apostle Paul had figured that out back when he had wrote to the folks there in Corinth. In 2 Corinthians chapter number 12, verse number 10, the Bible says, "Therefore, I take pleasure in my infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distress, for Christ's sakes. For when I am weak, then I am strong." Why is that? Because God props us up. We ain't never going to go through anything that God doesn't care about, and He props us up. He's got our back. Amen. Amen goes there. Not only is He is our help in time of need, He's really the only one that understands our needs. Amen. Why do you say that? We wrote to the folks at Philippi there in chapter 4, verse number 19. It says, "But my God shall supply all your needs according to His riches in glory by Christ Jesus." Amen. I got a big old rich God, owns everything. I take every need to Him. Why is that? Because He knows what I need. Amen. He really does. In times, we have no idea even what we need. That's an amazing thing. But God always does. Amen. You and I this morning, if you're in here this morning and you're saved, born again, child of God, you've been born again, the Holy Spirit is inside of you. You know, a lot of times the Apostle Paul was telling us in Romans chapter 8, verse 26, that we don't even know what to pray for. It says, "Likewise, the Spirit also helped our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray as we ought, but the Spirit itself making intercessions for us with groanings which cannot be uttered." I like the fact that it can't even be uttered, that the Holy Spirit has it all taken care of. When we need something, we don't truly ever really understand exactly what we need, but the Holy Spirit does. And I like this communication that the Holy Spirit has with the Father, because He's, you know, part of the Trinity. Amen. God inside of us. The fact of it is, He's there. He can speak with God and Jesus for our needs. Amen. In a language we don't even understand. We don't even know it's happening. Why is that important? Well, it's kind of one of these things where, you know, if Satan hears you say something, he might use it against you. You know, like the lawyers do in a court of law, whatever you say can be used against you. Well, guess what is? When the Holy Spirit is talking for you, it'll never be used against you. Amen. It can't be heard. Satan can't overhear and say, I'm going to get him on this one. I'm going to bug him on this one. I'm going to trip him up on this one. Why is that? Because the Holy Spirit has said it in confidence to the Father. Amen goes there. In groanings that you and I can't even understand. So in time, we come to the house of God, we should be seeking Him. You know, we should be like the woman with the issue of blood for 12 years. We really, truly should. We should come in here every Sunday morning, every Wednesday night, every Sunday night. We should be just trying our best to get a little touch of that garment of Him. Every time we come into the house of God, we truly should. Well, why's that? Well, we can approach Him boldly. Now, a lot of times people kind of misunderstand what the word boldly means, but when you look it up and you have to, I have to go lean on Mr. Strom because he knows more about it than I do. But when I get out my concordance and I read up on this word, I start understanding that this word boldness here is openness and it's freedom of speech. I can go to God and say anything I need to say to Him. I truly can. And I can go with Him with a confidence that whatever I tell Him is between me and Him, and the fact that I can come to Him boldly, and if it's in His will, it's all mine. Hallelujah. Because I have access to come to Him. Now, boldly don't mean I can just roll up in there being my own prideful, mean, old selfish self, but I can come to Him boldly and get His grace. Amen. Hallelujah goes there. Amen. We should approach Him boldly. Amen. Bringing our needs to Him boldly means we have confidence in who He is. Amen. Confidence in who He is. We have confidence in the promises that He's made for us, that He'll do what He's promised He'll do. Amen. Amen goes there. The fact that He can do something about our needs. Hallelujah. How about you this morning? Do you come to Him boldly this morning? Let me give them back to you real quick. Number one, don't forget, write them down. He is accessible, so we can come. Amen. A Christian in need, a sinner that is lost, Jesus is acceptable. Amen. Accessible. Amen. He is accessible. Number two, He has mercy for all. We'll never bankrupt this King. Amen. This high priest, He'll never run out of mercy. Amen. Number three, He is there in time of need. We bring our needs to Him boldly with confidence because He is God. Let us pray. Oh, gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, thank You for having us this morning.